The history of highly pathogenic avian influenza in the United States is actually long. This is not a new disease. And it was first discovered in 1878 when there was some high mortality, and researchers could discern this disease from other diseases that they already knew about. From the period of 1959 to 1956, there were only 15 reported incidents of high path in the United States. And at that point in time, it was considered low risk of causing widespread disease. So it was intense with the flock that it affected, but it didn't have the viral spread like we see today. The 2014-2015 event started in the fall of 2014, and it was an outbreak that moved from the western part of the United States, the coastal states, Oregon, Washington, and it moved east across the United States, hitting Minnesota in March of 2015. The final numbers for that outbreak, it reached 211 commercial flocks, 21 backyard flocks, and it affected over 50 million birds. Our event in 2022 was first identified in technically in the United States in January with a wild bird detection in the Carolinas, and is continuing to move westward. So it's moving east to west this time, again hitting Minnesota in March of this year. We know on Saturday, the 26th, is the first day that we had a confirmed case in the state of Minnesota. So while the virus is rare, it has been known about for almost 150 years, and it changes, which you will learn a little bit more as we go through these next few slides. So the cause of highly pathogenic avian influenza is, in fact, the influenza virus. Common signs of this virus are all related to similar respiratory symptoms. You might see an egg drop or death. And it's important to remember that viruses need a live host to live. Minnesota has a very large commercial poultry density. We're the number one turkey producer in the United States. We also have thriving broiler industries as well as egg layer industries, plus all of you who have small flocks. An important key to remember is avian influenza is never stable. That virus will always change. So the ability for the virus to change and spread from bird to bird is going to look different each time we have a new case within each flock. And the ability for the virus to cause disease is also going to change. Similar to how human influenza viruses can mutate and change from season to season. And as we've all experienced, there's different mutations of the coronavirus that it just keeps changing and mutating. In order for it to survive, it has to do that in those hosts. Avian influenza acts the same. So what truly happens when a flu virus changes? It becomes more virulent, meaning it becomes stronger. It reduces the infectious dose, meaning it's going to take less virus to infect a bird, and it can spread to new species. Influenza can be identified by three letter types: influenza A, influenza B, influenza C. You may be familiar with these types of viruses because that's how we identify them as humans. I'm not feeling well, I'm going to go get tested for influenza. Results come back, you do not have influenza A. So the influenza types are going to be categorized into A, B, and C. An epidemic can be caused by influenza A or B. A pandemic can only be caused by influenza A. Do not confuse this with the pandemic that we are currently dealing with coronavirus. coronavirus and influenza viruses are completely different beasts. Avian influenza is only an influenza A type virus. And influenza A is the only types of virus that can infect animals. In the news reports and in the media, you're going to hear the report saying that it's avian influenza H5N1. What does H mean and what does N mean? Well, influenza viruses are classified by a combination of two different proteins. And one of those proteins is the H, which stands for hemagglutinin. And there are 16 different H's. For an influenza virus to be considered avian influenza, it needs to be an H5 virus or an H7 virus. Then there are the N proteins. Those are neuraminidase, and there's 9 of those types of proteins. So potentially, with all the combinations, there's 144 different combinations, but then they can also subdivide and have different subtypes. So potentially there can be up to 264 subtypes of influenza virus. And it's important to understand that avian influenza, again, are only H5 and H7 viruses. So what does low path mean and what does high path mean? So we have our H5 and our H7 avian influenza viruses, and high or low literally means that it's going to be mild, non-fatal, meaning low pathogenicity, and poultry with low pathogenic avian influenza can recover from that virus. It's a much more mild virus and they do recover. Highly pathogenic means that it quickly spreads, it's very virulent, causing disease and illness, and poultry do die from HPAI. There's no opportunity for recovery. If we can pair the pathogenicity between low path and high path, you can see that low path, there's going to be mild symptoms. Like I mentioned earlier, it's a much more mild virus. You might see a decrease in egg production and would show signs of a typical or common respiratory illness. With highly pathogenic avian influenza, there's severe signs resulting often in death. Low path influenza is a common infection. We see a few cases each year. Those birds recover. Highly pathogenic avian influenza is rare. It's considered a foreign animal disease, which by definition means it does not exist on a regular basis in the United States. It is foreign to our continent and to our country. Low path avian influenza can spread through networks, and you can think of your networks being friends, neighbors, poultry groups, 4-H communities, your community that you live in the commercial industry. There's large communities, not just logistically, but also within their companies, the networks of who is where and what pieces of equipment is where. With highly pathogenic avian influenza, it also spreads through those networks as well as through proximity. So that's when we talk about the density of our population of birds, that can complicate the spread of the virus in its entirety. Low pathogenic avian influenza, again, there's H5 and the H7 viruses. However, which are H5 and H7 are avian influenza viruses, but birds can become ill with other H influenza viruses, which then are considered low pathogenicity. When high path affects, obviously you are all becoming aware that it is regulated because it's a foreign animal disease. Both low-path and high-path avian influenza have zoonotic potential. However, CDC reports that it is low risk for human infection, and the United States has not reported any human infections from H5 or H7 avian influenzas. With low-path avian influenza, the birds will stop shedding that virus after they seroconvert, meaning after they've built antibodies to the virus, they will stop shedding it, meaning they can recover, and then they are healthy birds. Highly pathogenic avian influenza, again, the birds do not recover. They will die from the effects of the virus. So how does influenza get to your farm? It's going to be initial point source contact from wild birds. We know that they are migrating this time of year, and we can suspect that they're going to visit a farm because there's spilled food, spilled grain, pools of water. Minnesota has spring hunting seasons for wild turkeys and light geese, such as snow geese or a Ross's goose. Fishing could become a risky activity later in the season, as well as trapping. And finally, a breach in biosecurity is what could allow influenza to be introduced on your farm. And so ultimately, what you need to know about influenza itself is that it is complicated, and you don't have to know everything to end an outbreak on your farm or to even and the virus as a whole, but you do need to know that it's a virus and it needs a host to survive, and that influenza viruses change and they will get worse before they get better. And you need to know when and how your birds are at risk. And that's why you're here this evening. And you need to know what decisions can be made for you to minimize your risk. Highly pathogenic avian influenza is regulated. It causes trade and business disruptions. It kills birds, and it truly is a bad deal. And low-path avian influenza causes little or no disease, but can also create some impacts with commercial industry. And all types of influenza can be prevented with some biosecurity actions for yourselves at home.